The first 6 months, all the things you hide in the courtship, they are going to come out. Your fiancé doesn't know that you snore, but the snoring will start from that place. Every time you are going out, you come dressed, but he's going to like know that you don't like bathing. As wabre bi sa na da fe mother, then you call. Hallelujah. Is there? All these things are going to show up. So that time, you need to be alone to make sure that you correct all these things. Most of the marriages that they start independent, it works. Most of the marriages that they are living with their parents, there's problem. I mean, I'm telling you, most of them that I know that they started in the whichever one, whether the woman or the man's parents' house, there's a problem. Bottom line, rent some uncompleted building somewhere, stay there and build your life. Me and my wife, we started in a single bedroom. We're there. We're fine. We were fine. Single bedroom, the good thing about it is that there's no another bedroom to go and look for anybody. Hey, who are here? How are you? Remember, I said, who are here? He's there. There's no, I mean, so that you, there's something called compatibility. That place, you must be compact. You have to bond. What did I say you have to do? You have to bond. And learn to do those things. Sometimes a site is going to market, you go with it. You have a small car, maybe you want to go to market. If you won't go to the market inside, yeah? Mommy doesn't believe it. His market will talk about Brochure Malata. That Brochure, we go there early morning. Don't say we're living in Bawi. Now we are living in a two, three bedroom house. Now listen, so the relationship there, when he became pregnant, I saw different things as we go. Then when he delivered, we have lived to his mother has come and stay with us. The delivery of the child brought also my parents. They didn't stay for long. They just came to visit a day to go. But his mother lived with us. It means that other mouths are going to be added. I will say some things during the dinner, but let me tell you this. Children can come to the marriage and destroy the marriage. It has nothing to do with the children. But it has to do with your attitude. Because some women, when they start giving birth, all the attention is left from their husband. They only give it to the child. And their statement can even make their husband start feeling lonely in the house. For instance, maybe your husband come home, he wants to do soakings. Your little baby has Cerelac or maybe Latoji. He takes a little, hey, my father's son, come about Latoji, you know. Hey, father's son, come, don't touch my child's food. Don't touch my child. And you realize that you don't give, you must be able to divide attention. All these things, it can affect the marriage. It can affect. Hey, I'm breastfeeding. Leave me alone. I'm tired. You know that Nadri, genie, my man, that won't swap out. You are coming to fire. So what? Am I genie? No. Children cannot be an excuse for anything. It's just a, so as you go on, extra load should be added. So the first child come, the marriage will change. Second one, it will change. Third one, it will change. It means that now there's something called divided attention. So you, the man, too, must prepare. You won't get the attention you get before the child arrives. And you must be able to adjust. For instance, just to not make your wife stressful, my children have different characteristics. Lanana Joa, she will never sleep. I don't know that because of the all-night thing. You have to always carry her. And sometimes, 1 a.m., the children, they change. Some of them, when everybody is awake, they are asleep. When you're supposed to sleep, then they are awake. And they want attention. Nana, I used to carry her. You just, shh. As for Nana Kwame, you have to even put her in the car and drive. You are going nowhere before he sleeps. So sometimes our neighborhood, I'm just driving around. You go, then you see he's sitting in the babysitter, then he sleeps. You drive her before you bring her. If you don't put her in the car, you put him in the car, he will never sleep. One day, a pediatrician with a friend came there and he realized that you are going somewhere with Nana. The moment you put her in the seat, the car starts. There is something about car engines with children. Then he sleeps. So at a point, I was telling them, I said, "Doc, this boy doesn't sleep." And he said, I heard you saying that I want to put him in the car. He said, "Then, prof, you have to put him in the car and drive." So you put him in the car, you drive, and he sleeps. So sometimes, mommy have to sleep, and I have to carry her. And that one, sometimes, even when he sleeps and you are coming to put her down, you have to go slow. And then you are coming. Sometimes, and you have to carry her. Sure? It was when I was raising the children, understand the scripture that say, honor your father and your mother. I saw the raising of the children, the things we went through. And then I said, this is why God said, because there are a lot of things that happen, you are not aware. Bishop T.D. Jay said that when you grow to see your grandchildren, then you see the compensation of what your grandchildren does to your children based on what they did to you. So sometimes his daughter will call and say, these children are driving me crazy. Daddy, will you do babysitter? He said, no, I'm about to go and preach. And he said, do you know what you did to me? This one is, he said, I won't say it for her to hear, but I say in my head, do you know what you did to me? And I'll begin to pray, children, do more. Grandchildren, do more. So that, yeah, that's what it is. It's not easy. And that is where sometimes it can bring all kinds of frustration. At that time, if you have a husband that is not sensitive, immature husband, in the name of bringing money, you can make a woman become very stressful, extremely. I was there to help. She said, "Nana Kwame, is the case? I change diapers, beaching that baby food. I'll go and buy. I'll feed the child. I am there. I did all those things. I help. I said, girl, you sleep. I'll handle it. I'll carry the child out so that you wake up and ask me, so what time did he sleep? I said, you don't worry. Then, no, you don't leave all those things for the woman. No. Sometimes, if it goes on, I'll wake her up and I say, girl, this one, sorry to wake you up, but I've tried that. It looks like this one is breast milk that will solve the problem. And then, at the point, we have to even buy something we used to pump the breast milk. And so, he pumped the breast milk, I put it in the fridge, and in order not to disturb her, when you're asleep, then I take the feeding bottle and I put it in his mouth and I carry her. You help. It's very important. Your wife will appreciate that you care. It is important for you to marry and let your wife feel like you care. You are contributing. Mommy believes that everything we wash must be iron. I didn't come from the house like that. We don't iron things like that. You only iron when we are going to church. Whether it's children, panties, and everything must be iron. So that is his belief. So no problem. We have this board, we go out. Then when he washes it, and I'll go and iron. Yes, there's nothing wrong. Sometimes you may think these things are extremely bad. You can afford. If at a certain point, at the beginning of the month, you can afford some small washing machine, buy one. It will reduce the stress. It doesn't cost you anything. Buy one. You can put it at the corner of the bathroom. Put things there. By the time you wake up, you iron it. Don't say, cinema. No. It's a stone. It's a traditional mentality. At check. So you go there and get ready for those things. Children will come. Things will change. All kinds of things. It comes up. You are not going to get your wife attention the way you used to get when the children has not come. The attention is divided. And if, assuming you go to work, I'm a pastor. Most times, if it's not office or program at home, so I have the chance to work. But if you go to work, then after the close of the work, division. For instance, at a point there, I was going to drop my wife at work. And then when I drop her, then we have to program such a way that we took Nana Kwame to a particular crèche that I will pick Nana and pick his mother, then we come home. Mm-hmm. We came to a certain place in life, then we need a driver. Or we took Nana Kwame to school, that the school has a small bus that pick the children and they bring them, then you pay. All this thing, you have to prepare for it. That is why I say that laziness can destroy the marriage. It means that you work out, the more you work out and you can meet in your knees, the easier the marriage becomes. So it's work. And then you don't live in any extravagant life. You plan. You give some to God. You save some, and you learn how to spend. By the time we have a budget, this is what we do. We live that way. We save, and the reason you must save, you have to have savings, is that you need savings for emergencies. And then you learn all these things, how to divide attention. You are helping, and you are making sure that. And then I'm going to talk about some things on Sunday, that complaints that come out, how you respond. Some of them you fish it out. Taking your marriage through what I call marriage servicing. That at a point you ask your wife, what are the things I do you don't like? Because a lot of the Christian women in the church, they are trained to pretend. And you have to be sincere. And whatever you say, you don't use it against her because you were fishing it out. I ask mommy, what are the things I do that you don't like? And sometimes when you voice them this and this, and I say, okay, thank you. And I say, give me opportunity. I promise you I'm going to change. I promise you this thing will not be repeated. Yes. Because if I don't ask, I will know. Sometimes, you know, the first time I ask the teenager, I have my mind. I know he's going to say this because this one there, I know I did it. Me, myself, I knew I did it. Yes. I shouted. I said something. And I realized that those things, he didn't complain. So sometimes the things you think offend your wife might not be the things that offend. The things you talk were minor things. I was shocked. I was very sure. That is why I realized that it is easy to take somebody for granted that you are not aware.
Yes.
And I said, oh, wow, rich, rather. I say, well, it's just these ones, I don't like it, but fine. But this particular one, no. And I know, like, daddy, can you tell me some of those things? No, because you are not mommy. Your temperament is different. What can offend her will not offend you. And what will offend you will not offend her. That is what the Bible says. Have dwell with them according to knowledge. You don't need to have knowledge of every woman. Have knowledge about the woman you have married. Have knowledge about the man you have married. There is another thing. And I'll say this and end. Don't come to church and kowtow and respect your pastor and go home and disrespect your husband. If you think you see me and daddy, and your hands is on your back, do almost the same thing to your husband. The reason is that if you start doing that, you may make the man resent the church and even hate the man that God is using to bless you. It's hypocrisy for you to meet your spiritual father, daddy, good morning, daddy, I'm fine. Then your husband wants to catch a chumu, and that, no. I've never had one. Never. I'm telling you, me, I can do all kinds of things because I'm very unpredictable. I'm not saying mommy is perfect. I have things that still I'm working. He's working on me, I'm working on her. But to lift his voice against me, insult, shouting, or any disrespect, I've never seen one. Maybe it will happen tomorrow. But up to this 21 day, I have never. I have done things that a woman naturally must react. But no. And sometimes, as a woman, you have to learn. Let me repeat this again. Silence cannot be misquoted. And there are times, for the sake of peace, even if you are right, you should be able to say, honey, I don't mean to hurt you. But if I've done something that hurt you, please, I'm sorry. The word I'm sorry, we'll talk about it next time. The keys that stabilize marriage, I'm sorry. Please, honey, peg names. Answering questions with respect. Responding. Yesterday, I wanted to go there, but I couldn't. But responding. Are you getting it? Compliment. Thank you very much. Sometimes I travel and I cook. And mommy will tell them, hey, you people are eating the food. You should go and thank daddy for cooking for you. And he comes back. Yeah. Sometimes I'm cooking, I go to a place and then I got confused. I go wake up again. This one, what is the content of the salt? How do I do it? I remember one day I did something. My children, they love a particular meat called tolo beef. Do you know tolo beef?
Yeah.
Yes. It's very nice. Wow. If you don't know it, go and find one. And that's what we're doing. Tolo beef now. Now, some of them are very salty.
But the natural way, the normal way, let me. One day I used some to cook and the food became over salty. So mommy came and said, oh boy. He said, you have to boil it and pour the water away, boil it and pour. And he taught, most of the food I cook, I literally learn it. I asked her to teach me how. And I do it. I do it just to create a romantic atmosphere. It's fine. My girls, they love my food. Yesterday, they go, daddy, when will you cook? I say, Ghana, no cooking, please. I'm here for preaching. Amen. Yeah. When I come here, they don't. There are too many people there. They won't even permit it. But when I travel with them, we cook. It doesn't cost you anything. If you look somewhere, chinko shani first and three chema, no what two ago, another one. Yeah. One day I did something. It tells them, see, I did where they'll be, and I'm sure, I just wipe it straight. And no fun to ball and what you call the main ball on the side, so that nobody will trace it out. Not to throw it away. Mommy came and said, ah, and because you're not those who are swatting, I'm saying that you are with me. Some spirits be on with you, go see. Then I will cut it there. Later, when I confirm, I say, aha, because the way the egg just, I say, no. Doesn't cost you anything. Just make it work. Have the mind to make it work. Let me tell you something. Having a peaceful home is a blessing. It's a blessing. It's a blessing. So that you just pay the price for the peace. I don't want to do anything that brings confusion. So I'm not talking about the one that that is not it. You are doing it with the purpose of making it work and creating a sound atmosphere. No resentful attitude. Amen. And you keep going. One day I tell a couple. The husband was talking to me and said, daddy, since my wife started having children, as if me, I'm not needed in the house. And my children, and don't take my children's food. And I told the woman one day, I said, madam, these children came to meet you in the marriage, and one day they will leave you. So don't destroy your marriage, because one day they will go. One day, the moment you see them start calling my old man, they are going. One day I heard an akwami tell his mama, hey, where's the old boy? I said, hey. It has started. They will leave you. Amen. I'm an old boy. That's how he has started calling me. They will leave you. By the time you go to university and come back, so they will leave you. One day we wake up, we realize that almost all of them were in boarding houses. Then I told her, I said, girl, we have come back to the early days. So do you remember? Say, now come in on quiet. Yeah, boy. Amen. We are here. We are the only 2 years. They were in a boarding house. And when I left go to school, I realized that only the 2 of us. And I told her, I remember when we started at Bawe and Odoko. We have come back and we are there. They will leave you. So they should not break the relationship. All of them will go. One day they will go. They only come and visit you. But they are gone. Amen. Companionship, intimacy is very crucial. So all these things are going to come. And that is what I talk about. The friendship love. The eros love is another word for erotic. So there's nothing wrong with erotic love. Creating a romantic atmosphere. Pegging, kissing. You don't only kiss that is there. You don't only kiss when it's sex. You can just meet your wife somewhere and then give a kiss and you continue. You just create the atmosphere. Amen. Yeah. Sunday we'll talk about things. Combination of things to wear. Because men are moved by what they see. Mommy will not get on a chair. A chair. Hey. A chair. A chair, a chair, a chair, a chair. I remember mommy had some dress bead on the cocky chain. One day, we shut up. Saturday, no cry. I want to say, boss up. No, you must show. But on Saturday, I have to throw it, I have to dash it somewhere. On Saturday, we wash. So, what crime of any arose on a crime was, ow, because he thought it's you that is standing inside. Let me tell you something. If you are a woman, change is very important. Do everything so that your husband will not get used to you. Change your hairstyle. Today, rasta. The next day, wig. The next day, cut out. The next day, tongue in. Change it. So that he doesn't become used to you. Don't force him to accept you. No. Change your bed sheet. Sometimes white, sometimes pink, sometimes that. Change it. Just make sure that you're always creating something new. Change it. Amen. I'm talking from Jupiter. Don't do in the name of Sikeniho. You destroy your marriage.
doesn't call. Bedsheet, you can get some in Ofos. We used to buy Obroni Wahoo bedsheet. Very thick one, and it was not made in Ghana. The thing they import is different from the thing they use in their country. Now, if you can afford store one, fine. You don't need to. Change. Don't be used to get 3 or 4 nightgown. Sometimes surprise your husband. A lot of women come, my husband has not touched me. Have you created the atmosphere for him to touch you? Amen.
Amen.
Change. Don't get, men look at the outward. Change. Get some 90s. I will tell you some things. I will tell you. Me, in my case, you might not get a man like me. I know when I meet pastors who have committed adultery and they are telling me their stories. Some of them tell me because at the point their wives are not attractive. So I learn. One of my white man friend who is far older than me, say, Nana, when you see anything in the mall that you like, buy it for your wife. Almost a lot of mommy's 90s, I'm the one who buy them. There is a shop called Victoria's Secret in America. Victoria's Secret, I'm there. And then when you turn, when you boss, I say, I'm in frame. If you see me paying those because I'm quite a friend in it, I'm in frame, I'm in Jahami preaching. I have survived. I buy them. Sometimes I'll bring it, mommy say, hey. Sometimes even this, hey, the prophet of God. I say, Adeo, yeah. I am not only a prophet, I'm a naughty boy. Wear the thing for me. One day I told her, I say, girl, one day when you hear a pastor has committed adultery, do you know the pressure that is on the wife? Get used to. I buy them. Buy things. You have not started going to America yet. When there was no America, I used to buy it at Usu. There are shops. It doesn't cost you anything. Buy it. Wear them. I mean, what you use to sleep must be transparent. It must be nice. You must have dresses that you wear at home. There are things I buy for mommy. Very short, hot jeans. And it's only for the house. We are sitting in the sofa. We are watching TV. I don't want to see those things. No. Sometimes we are sitting there watching TV. He puts his leg on me. And sometimes I'm filing his nails. And then we are watching. We file my nails. Sometimes he's filing my own for me. Say, hey, look at your nails. And then Nana, bring me the file. Then I'm there. Then he's filing it. Sometimes I'm filing my fair mother. It's me there. Marry your friend. This is there. All this thing help. They will not come automatically. It doesn't work. Because every time you are standing there in the morning, you hold your hand, let's pray. In the afternoon, you come back. Mommy, you're going to buy a bonus. You'll kill her. Undo those things. Amen. It will interest you to know that most times, mommy and the children that join me in devotion, but I don't really call them because my times of prayer is different. Sometimes I can wake up midnight and pray. So sometimes they join me, and sometimes I tell them, I say, when you join me and you see that I have not stopped, you can end your own and go. And then they go. But these things are very important. They will not tell you, but I'm telling you, if your husband is not touching you, you must be able to ask questions because men are different kind of men. No, I know who I am. I am somebody that like new things. I get used to things. And I have told my wife things I like and things I don't like. Sometimes I tell her, I say, girl, this your hair, it has been there for 3 weeks. I don't want to see it. Bam! Even yesterday, I told her. This morning when I wake up, I saw that I was praying. When I said, why are you? I said, I'm in a saloon. I said, why do you go to the saloon? You remember you told me the hair, ache. And chair, so say ache. Because it's an amount. I said, okay, and chair, nabra. That is it. I get used to. No. Very important. Hallelujah. You may think I'm far home, but it's causing because the way you are looking some way, there are other women around your husband looking very attractive. Why does people chase young girls? Why does married men chase young girls? Because the young girls are looking attractive. Because they are not married yet, they don't take dressing for granted. This is it. Now, I'm saying this and I'm generalizing it because you may marry a man that is not as spiritual as I am. And that is the reality. He does not understand. He's not as mature as I am in the things of God. Even if he's mature, there is a place of temptation. Do the best you can and leave the rest for God. But there is another topic I've never preached, and it's called taking one another for granted. The fact that you have a baby does not mean you shouldn't look attractive. The fact that you are pregnant does not mean you should look like, I don't know the word to use. In every stage, you can look good. Amen. Yeah. Have I blessed somebody here today? I am dealing with things that is messing up. And this one may look very insulting, but I have to tell you, Madam, be neat. Neatness. Be neat. The fact that you are quiet, my point is very validated. Be neat. You are the driver of your home car. Much as the woman, the man is the head, you actually control the car of the house. Richard Roberts said, my father always tell my mother, hey honey, I'm the head. The mother will say, I'm the neck. And it's the neck that turns the head. So you turn it. You are the one who turned the home. So keep it. You are. And when you marry, realize that everybody has their strength. I am not too good. I don't care how a bedroom looks like. I still struggle to lay the bed. Right now, I came here, I didn't lay the bed. But that is mommy's strength. You arrange everything, but me outside, to beautify outside, I will do it. Landscape, garden, pot, this one. So you come to the house, that is where. Now, we live and everybody operate from where their strength is. So it's naturally agreed. So when I go back, I can remove this one, put it here. When he come, he pick them. He doesn't talk, complain. Sometimes when my naughtiness go and they cannot put it, say, hey boy, you have tried though. Today you have arranged your things very nice. Wow, give me a high five. Pa, then I put it there. The next time I get back to my naughtiness again, that is it. But the outside, I don't even do invite. I don't get it. I will do everything. Come to our home, flowers, this thing, that. Recently was telling me, the park is spoiling. I said, don't worry, I'll work on it. That's it. So everybody works on their strength and you don't complain. Amen. You don't. Sometimes, then we joke. They say, hey, so couldn't you pack your chairs? If I do that, if I pack them, you have a job to do and you must get something to do. So just, you'll be fine. Hallelujah. And mom must work and so get something to do. I just created a job for you. I'm too glad that I'm creating job opportunities for people in this house. And we joke about it and we go, create fun, laugh. Don't tension your home. Don't make the home. Don't bring it to the place of tense. Don't make the room become tense. No. Amen. Conflict resolution, we'll talk about it later. If something happens, it's not possible that you won't disagree. It's not possible. In fact, there's a point I say, make anger your ally. Make him your friend so that you will know how to handle it. It means that the problem is not getting offended or disagreeing. It has to do with how to solve it. Quickly. Somebody must quickly initiate and say, I'm sorry. Don't, for instance, we have a law. We don't go to bed with offense because we have to hold our hands and pray. So we don't go, we don't sleep with anger. No, it has to be solved. And all this thing will not come, they are not a gift of the Spirit. You initiate it and you solve it. I'm sorry. Somebody must be able to say, I'm sorry. And you have to say for the sake of peace. Because if you tense in the home, you invite the devil. Satan loves a very tense, angered, and resentful atmosphere. The Holy Ghost likes peaceful atmosphere. So, create a very peaceful atmosphere. The Spirit of the Lord will come and stay there. May the Lord bless you. Amen. I have addressed some things now. That we are going to talk about deeper things. It's points, 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 Sunday dinner, points, 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 points. We have to start the movie from about 4 o'clock. And then from 4:30, from by 5, later 6, I start preaching. We are not going to stay there for long. We will eat along the line. It's going to be a buffet. Pay the money and pay for somebody. Amen. Pay for your friend. Hallelujah. Pay for your fiancé. There is a guy who give you a lift. Tell him to pay for you. All right. I'm going to receive 5 questions. And then I'll get up. So get a microphone. Hallelujah. I think today, I have packaged from dating, the only thing I didn't talk about is funeral. But that one I didn't talk about because I will talk about that when we are 88 years. When we are 88, then I'll start introducing the topic. By the time you are 88, when I'm doing the marriage counseling, then I'll talk about those things because that time. Okay, give it to the gentleman there. Amen.
Good afternoon, Daddy. Thank you so much for the teaching.
Amen.
My name is Benjamin.
Okay.
I want to ask a question.
Go ahead, Ben.
I think you talked about the compatibility, especially at the beginning of marriage, mm-hmm. that if by God's grace the child doesn't come in early, it is the best. But in this case, maybe in the side of family planning, the couple are really planning that we don't want the child to come early. I know in family planning we have a lot of them, and when somebody asks me this question, that's why I'm putting out, and it mm-hmm. goes in line. It was like there's a scripture in the Bible where a man was supposed to procreate for his brother when he took over.
No, it's an Old Testament law. You can't apply it in the dispensation of grace.
Okay.
You are talking about the one that I think the Israelites are culture, like what happened to Tamar, to Tamar and Judah.
Yeah. So that instance, somebody mm-hmm. asks, okay, maybe I'm married, but we don't have the child now, mm-hmm. and during the sex, I will pull out, and that's that. Someone was asking, is that wrong? Is that a sin? Since there is that kind of thing in the scripture, God punished that man. He just wanted to. He asked me.
Oh, okay. So, like during the sex, instead of releasing the sperm,
because you don't want to have the child now.
And pull out. Like, well, if it's a sin, then things like family planning, do you say it's a sin? It's the same thing. What about even tablets and things that people insert just to weaken the sperm so that they don't produce? I can't judge those things as sin. I don't think I am in a stand to do that because the reason why, let me balance the equation here. The reason is also that if you don't space the children, let's say you become pregnant and 6 months that you become pregnant, it can also cause a problem in the house. Amen. That is a method you have chosen. Now, the reason why people don't even advise those methods is that there is a place that the realm where you are, you can't pull anything. Are you married? Okay, so we can't continue with you. Hallelujah. Unless you are a bad boy, then you are not married. No. That is why. Also, can I tell the truth to them?
Yes.
No. This thing is not something you are pulling what? You even forget the word pulling. All the women who are laughing, the reason they are laughing is that they know what I'm talking about. No. So, there are all kinds of things people use. And maybe tell the guy that his method is good, but there's a time you even forget. So, if that is a method you are using to space children, I don't want to call it like it's a sin. And it's that dispensation. It's even with only the Israelites. Nothing of that is said in the New Testament. And so it's not something that you are going to make it like a law. And the story appears even with one particular person, it never got repeated. That they are saying that, and Moses put it in the law, that when you have 5 brothers and the first one married doesn't have child, then if the senior brother died, then the second one automatically must marry. There is even another debate that the Bible is silent about. What about if the second one is married already? Does it mean you make the other woman a second wife or something? So there's a lot of things surrounding it. But I don't think, simply put, you are just doing what they call planning the family. The word family planning means, family planning does not mean that you shouldn't have sex or anything. Family planning have to do with spacing. It does not even mean that, you can still do family planning and have 8 children. Family planning has nothing to do with the number of children you have. It has to do with the space so that you don't be under pressure. So what they do is that planning the family, it's simple planning the family. It has nothing to do with all this have less children. It has to do with your pocket. Do you know even in China now you can have more children, but you pay? So the Chinese are saying that you present your bank report, they see that you have money, and then they can allow you to have two or three children. Because they think that it is not good for you to have children and not take care of them. So if it is one, then stay with the one. Family planning does not mean that reduce the number of children. It has to do with planning such a way that you will not be under pressure to raise them. Because there are people who can have five children, it will cost them nothing. I know a man who is a very wealthy man, is my friend. He has about four children. He has adopted another four with his name on them, because he said all his life he always want to have more children. And some of the adopted children, they mix up with the children that they don't even, it takes them from babyhood. They don't even know that they adopted until they grew up. Yeah. So I don't think that is going to be an issue. But I want to tell you, if that's a method you are adopting, be careful, because when you get there, you see that it has not worked for Pastor Abed, it will not work for you. When you are there, that the tendency to say you are bringing something out to pull it somewhere, you, by the time you know, it has rather, okay, let me leave it there. Amen. Amen. Man na man. Yes, second question. Amen.
Okay, so, Baba, can I go online?
Online, yes, right. Why not?
Okay.
Finance. So we pick one here and one online.
Right. Finances.
Finances, yes. I didn't go there, cry. Okay. But I will talk a little bit during the dinner.
Okay.
It's going to be more on money and sex.
All right.
More. Okay, so go ahead.
What must a lady do if the husband-to-be comes to him asking for a loan from her 2 days to their engagement, so to settle her bride price, because the money he planned to use has not yet been paid to him, and he has no funds anywhere he can access for the marriage?
Well, Osofo, it's a very broad topic because of the way people handle finances in marriage. For instance, do we call it borrowing? When we went for the list for my engagement, I was supposed to bring 6 clothes. I didn't have them. I remember my mother gave me 2. Then my wife suggested that he has 4. We added it. So the clothes I presented was for her. I remember the question I asked, what about if they open it? Because his mother used to sell clothes. So, and then my wife said, they will open because you wrap all of them and it's in a suitcase. You have heard me say things like, we even have a joint account before we got married. It all has to do with the way you plan your destiny. You are going to marry. When I was getting married, mommy was working in a bank. I was a pastor. My salary was not anything compared to what he earns. But if there is anything he put into the relationship, it was not something to go and borrow. I don't know. Sometimes when they put the question, the way they put it is very difficult. But do you understand where I'm coming from? If you are going to marry 2 days to the engagement, so the money is borrowed, is it for the engagement to pay? What is the bride price? How much does the bride price cost? I don't know. It's a long time. I'm talking about over 20 years, 21 years thereabout I got married. But I remember when we went there, in my case, we said categorically that we are not going to present any alcoholic drink. No libation, no nothing. So all the things were in envelope. They have a list. They say a contact daddy or something, they will present. They have this thing they mention, they present. Clothes, you present. It depends on the culture, and it depends on the culture and the tradition, whatever they demand. So all the things like schnapp and everything, we make it drinks. Some of them we make it money and we present it. How much is he borrowing? Now, fine. Lend the money, but it's bad debt. Now, can you imagine? Okay, if I'm walking on earth and the only person I own is mommy, will I even have sleepless night about it? No. So it's not really important to say about that. It means that there is too much apart system in the marriage. It's like everybody's going their own way. This kind of unity is not working. No. The wife doesn't know anything about the husband. The husband doesn't, especially those who live in the West. Everybody's living in something. So you are, that's why I didn't want to go there, because I have to really master the topic to go there. United and unity. God unites you, but whether you live in unity, that is your responsibility. And the two shall be one, that is united through sex. But living in unity is your responsibility. I told you, all my visa cards, mommy knows the password. He knows it. There's nothing. I know the password to his visa card. Yes, straight. Sometimes when you travel, he's going to buy something. I say, use my card. No. The only thing is I tell, I say, don't go to anywhere they will ask for ID card. Sometimes they will ask you ID card. But even the ID card, the only thing you see the difference is the IV. But the Opokusa card there, it is there. So sometimes my name, I leave it just Opokusa card there. So once they see the first America, they talk something about first name and second name. Something that, but he knows it. That is how we live. There's nothing to hide. Now, sometimes those things also came. You see, also for this thing is broad. You know, there was a time I keep telling you that God is giving me the burden of doing online something, and I'm struggling, and I say that do the studio, and I recently the Lord said, this is what I was telling you because of the feedback. Let me tell you, there are also relationships. In my case, there are some things I cannot explain to you because I've not experienced it. I love to preach experiential mercy. Whatever happened between me and my wife, we all grew up, suffer, and we had it. However, you can also go and marry somebody who has made his money already. So that one, I don't know how it works. Because maybe this guy, he has worked hard and make his money, and we are going to marry. Because now, even America, you know, some of these Hollywood people, some of the ladies go and marry them, then they divorce them, and then so now they make a new law. Before you are going to marry, all the things that he has, they list them. So that when you divorce him, you are not part of those things. They have changed the law. So, but in the context of the way we marry, everything is together. Now, I have my account. Mommy has his account. But even my account, it's not a hidden account that I have something that he doesn't know. He knows I have account in the command. He knows that this. Sometimes you might not be too inquisitive to find out how much it is. And I can tell you that we don't keep this thing called chop money or housekeeping money. We call it chop money because all our house, there's a particular drawer that sometimes money is inside. So that we say, okay, this whole month, the money here is about running the home is about, let's say, 3,000. Is there. As at when you need it, everybody goes there, you pull it. He's going there, like today, he's going somewhere with the children. He just go there, takes it. If there's something will go beyond that, he draw my attention, boy, we need to go and buy books for the children, but we need so, so, and so, and so, and so, and so. I think that the last time I bought it, so, now, the ones he can solve, he solve it. The ones he can't, he draws my attention, we come in. It's not a struggle. That's the difference between united. You are united in marriage, but are you living in unity? How do you lend money to a guy that is going to marry you? He is taking the money to go and pay your bride price. You can't call it low. You are just supporting. No. Yeah? Also, I have seen marriage that is the woman that did everything. A lot. That one too. After the woman has spent all the money to for give it to you for you to marry, are you going to stay faithful after you have made money? You see, all these things are coming in and the borrowing and lending because of the history of the way things have been handled in the past. So it's very difficult to answer the question. Yeah, because there are girls who have helped some boys and after they stand on their feet, hey, yesterday when I was reading, remember the girl said that I pay my husband's school fees, I even lent him money, now he's standing on his feet and he has made money, now he's chasing girls. Yeah. Mommy took care of me, honestly. Took care. I remember our first house in Manet, he was working in a bank. And he took some facility. Yes. Later, God bless us, so we have to go and clear it. But if you look at, his money was more into it than me. But because we are united, there was nothing. At that time, nobody even called his money his money. The money is for all of us. And we grew up until God started blessing us. Are you getting what I'm talking about? So it's a very big topic. It's very, you have to answer it in a certain way. Why does the girl, why is she feeling reluctant to lend money to the guy? She has heard a story before. Mm-hmm. Are you getting it? In my case, so most of the things that we use for the engagement, he works in the bank. We're saving the money small, small. We are discounting to our need to be at to need to be at to. And as a result of the way we're saving the money, majority of the money we used to marry, he provided it. I remember he was telling me, should I take some facility? I said, no, no, if you didn't take loan, let's do the thing the way. And small, small, small. My wedding like this, people pay for the wedding. I remember I have some family friends and some uncle, one uncle be call me, hey, I hear you are coming to marry you. Should I pay for the reception? Somebody appeared. I said, oh, no, uncle, bring me the money. Yes, I collected the money, put it in my pocket. Seriously. So, also, it's very difficult to answer the money, the question. But the question, I also want to ask a question. Sometimes Jesus used question to ask, answer a question. The power you operate, is it from God or from, where is it from? You see, I also ask you a question. John the Baptist, where is it from? The people say, if you say from God, you say, why don't you believe me? So you say, I don't know where. So Jesus said, neither will I also tell you where the power is coming from. Okay. If you don't lend him the money, can the marriage goes on? Are you also ready to marry? Okay. Let's take one inside and we come to online.
Thank you, Daddy. My name is Marian.
Yes, Marian.
So on the issue of submission and the fact that your body belongs to your husband and his also belongs to you.
I'm not the one who said it, it's the Bible. So let's go. Instead of saying on the issue, say, I know the Bible says.
Yes,
so
Daddy.
That we are all standing.
Yes,
Anna,
Daddy.
Marian,
okay.
So quote, say the Bible says.
The Bible says. Yes. So I'm asking this question for myself personally and also to acquire knowledge to be able to also advise certain people. So based
like
on the scripture.
Not I'm cutting, I like that. One of the reasons why you have to listen to this is that all the things you are teaching, sometimes you have to advise people with it. I like what he just said. Because some of you are in the offices, people come to you and tell you about their marriage problems. And you need to go and get it. Thank you for that point. Continue.
So there are some acts that married people engage in, and I would want to hear from you if some of those are right or wrong. So one was what Bernard said, that's the coitus interruptus. So that one is cleared, it's not a sin. I would want to know about oral sex. Secondly,
that one, how does it work? Well, I've heard it. What the oral sex?
Okay.
But how much has pointed to it? I should ask you.
So
you're two senior pastors. No, I mean, honestly, what is the oral sex?
Okay, so that is the oral sex. You have the blow job. The blow job is when you put your husband's
okay.
The licking, that okay, the one that the man gives the woman. Okay, then there's the anal sex.
Hey, that is the anus one.
Yes, please.
Hey, yes, sir. That be that place, they don't go there.
And then
I beg you.
And then there is the sex when the woman is having her light period. So maybe you have your period for 6 days, maybe the 3 or 4 days is heavy, and the last 2 days is light. Like it doesn't, the blood is not much. So during that period. So I would want to know about these also.
Okay. The oral sex and those things, maybe I don't want to put it, I'll put it in the context of part of the romantic things that you do. It depends on the individual. Once you are married, legally married, whatever you do in the bedroom around your sexual life, I won't call it sin. But there are things you do like anal sex and things. It is not what the Bible said. God didn't make anus for sex. Because the reason I'm saying is that I've had a lot of doctors talk about the problems people have had, especially you, the man yourself, and even the woman, some of the people, the anus has developed infections and problems because God didn't make it for that. Why do you want to use exit when there is, I don't understand. Now, so is it oral sex, he said, and which one again? There's sex during your period. In fact, all those, I overheard one great man of God say, let's say your husband has traveled for 4 months and he comes back and you are in your light period.
What do you do? Ehono. I don't have any scripture to stand on. So I leave it for you. When it comes to the sexual things, as long as you are doing the context of what God has said, and you are married couples, fine. Bedroom matters there. If that is what makes you happy. I can't call it a sin. I cannot call it that. Maybe somebody leak the husband's manhood, and then you say that because there are people here, it has been leaked before, but they are sitting quiet like they don't know what I'm talking about. But the leaking is there. It's there. Yes. So I don't want to go there. It's too complicated for me to talk about it. So women are looking at me straight as if they don't know what I'm talking about. It's not only chewing gum they chew. Kizivizi atoyas. What the enemy be our mommy and Franco Dina? Our light in the crowd will give us permission to talk about it. But honey, Mary, I don't want to call it a sin. But something like anal sex, I don't want to. I don't think it's advisable. I don't think that your womanhood is there and your husband is going to another. I don't think it will be comfortable. And let me tell you something. There is another dimension. That's why I say be spiritual. Don't go and do things that demons will take over. Full stop. There is something about the devil. He likes to take over perversion. Don't do things that will go to the spiritual dimension. Don't do things that the demons will come and take over. Because that is not what God said you should do. Amen. Yes, Abed, want to add something? Okay.
With the oral sex, there is a caution because people have gotten throat cancer out of that. It's scientifically proven.
Wow.
So it's advised that you make sure you are not infected. Mm-hmm. That is, if the woman has an infection, it can affect the husband. Mm-hmm. So it's advised that you make sure you are. You are not infected.
How would you even know whether it doesn't have
infection? Exactly. So, and then you are clean.
Because the way your wee-wee is yellow, it's chances that there's an infection. Hey, chances are that there's an infection. How can we tell about that one?
So it must be done under caution.
No, so far, I really love the point. I love the point. Hallelujah. Yeah. Well, anyway. It's a gray area. It's not in the Bible. It's just blank. It's there. That's why I say that. Me, I want to stay in the context of the word of God. But whatever you want to add up in your bedroom, fine. But I like the point. Maybe the man one is very difficult for the infection. It's dead. That one is on pejari at the end and no crown. So infection can come. Oh, yeah. Everything. Throat cancer and tongue cancer. And do you know, every sickness, there's a demon behind it. That is my belief. So don't go and do anything and get yourself into trouble. Amen. Yeah. Are you getting it? There are other ways that you can handle things that it will be fine. Like kissing. We'll talk about some things and talk about that. Like he said, I like what he says. So scientifically proving that the cancer was down there, you took it to your throat. And you can tell your infection by the color of your wee-wee. You can look at it and say, the way this wee-wee is yellow, there is there are sometimes, do you know some wee-wee smell? Some people, their wee-wee smells extremely. So sometimes when you travel, you go to the, let's say, mall, you go to somebody's wee-wee at the men's house, you can feel the scent that is coming. Yeah, very strong. So all this other, bedroom matters. Look at somebody say, bedroom matters. Me, it's no matter. Hallelujah. And some of you that say bedroom, you are not in bedroom yet, but you have those matters. Coconut 3 matters, mango 3 matters, all of them is there. Amen. Let me tell you something. The sex thing has been perfected by the devil. And he's using it in different ways. What is the solution to it? Be spiritual. We'll talk about some things, but like I said, I really appreciate Pastor Abed's contribution.
and especially scientifically proven. So do it with caution. Maybe get some rubber tight in your mouth or something. Maybe, I don't know. The way you want to. Well, yes. Also, online. Because our questions, you will come Obia will come up with their angles and that. I want to stay in the context of the Bible. The Bible never talk about oral sex. However, I can also say it's a sin. However, I don't also want you to get throat cancer.
Mm-hmm. We got married as Christians, mm-hmm. serving God together.
Mm-hmm.
And one backslides, stopped church, and even joined the occult. Eesh. And begins to fight against
you going to church.
Me going to church. Mm-hmm. Is it biblically permitted for you to leave the marriage? And if you do, can you remarry again?
Wow. Complex questions. And the reason is because today I was telling God that I wish that Sunday I will not even go online. Because you see, I'm really praying about it, 50-50 and see. Because I'm going to share some things about personal life. I'm going to share some things that I feel like it's my life, but it can be an experience, can be a good lesson for you. Mm-hmm. But somebody sitting somewhere just listening to you with all the idea and its culture. I mean, when you are just with the people that there's a certain presence, control, and anointing that even got it. Yes. But also, listen to this question. Number one. The answer is it good for me to leave the marriage or divorce the marriage? The answer is yes and no. Yes, because I said something in the course of my teaching that when you marry, your husband is your head. I like the way you are generalizing, but I will speak it from it is difficult for a woman to backslide from a marriage, join the occult, and try to force the man. Normally, 99.955% is coming from the man. So I want to talk about it from that angle. And I'm trying to say that. The man you marry is your head, but he's not your Lord. If you remember, I learned the things I said that. And I said the difference between submitting, and I said sometimes submission does not mean obedient. And I really emphasize about it. If you heard me, it means that I love you. I'll give everything that you, as a woman, as my responsibility to do for you. But you are not the one to take me to heaven. Mm-hmm. And so if it has to do with something that you want to cut me from eternity with Christ, then that one, I will not submit. So you cannot force me to join the occult. Because this is what Jesus said about this situation. Two people will be lying in the bed. One will go to heaven and one will left. What happened that the other one left? Maybe he has joined another society. So don't push me inside. Because there is no marriage in heaven. Because there is no marriage in heaven, I'm not going to continue marrying you in heaven. Marriage is a temporary thing on earth. And however, even now that you are forcing me to join you into whatever your society, if I die now, will you marry again? So that's why I'm saying yes or no. However, if it's in a situation that he is not only forcing you to join or stop following Jesus, and he's just in his society, and he leads you to go to church, then maybe with prayer and fasting, maybe you can bring him back. Because remember, he's a backsliding person. She used to be in Christ, and maybe your prayer can bring him back. But in a case where there is pressure for you to stop serving Jesus, That one. I think you have to step out. That notice. And if you ask me that, is it good for you to just marry? Because the reason I'm saying this is because it sounds similar to a case I know. It was not only just at a point, it came to the place of started beating the woman. You go to church, you come, slaps. Didn't I tell you? The man even come to the church, drag you and all kinds, until people step in and say that they should be separation. Now, do you know something? In the West, like America and those things, if you slap your wife, the authorities will come after you. They will even give you a certain perimeter that you cannot come around the woman. But Ghana here, they can kill you for free. So, you are my husband, but you are not my Lord. And therefore, I won't let you divert my course to her. I'm not too sure whether if I've answered the question well, but he has a, if only you go through divorce and God granted you divorce based on the evidences you brought that he is trying to change my belief. That's why we call something freedom of worship. Yeah. In this church, I have some people here, their husbands are Muslims. But the men are cool with it. They are raising children. The men go to, the woman come to church, and the man doesn't complain. The man doesn't, there's nothing. He also go to his mosque. This one come. The reason is because they marry in the world before the woman become born again. The man has not changed yet. She was not a Christian before he met the man as a Muslim and they got married. Later he became a Christian. And the man is not putting any pressure that come to the mosque. Go to your church. I'm going to my place. With prayer, Paul said that the unbelieving woman must not leave their husband. Who knows whether by the grace of God, your grace will convert them. But in a case where they are forcing you to come out of Jesus Christ, that is another angle. So I think that is it. Amen. Yes.
Yeah, Daddy, mm-hmm. Earlier on you said during courtship, if you realize that your partner's parents don't like you, you run. So what happens if your partner's father likes you?
No, I didn't just say that. I said some of them, you can pray, and by the grace of God, it will change. Because I know some that, I even gave an example of somebody. You see, you have to find their reason. Once they don't like you, there must be a reason why. Some of them can be tribalistic. In the case of the example I gave, it was educational system. The man said that my daughter is a graduate and I won't let him marry somebody who is undergraduate. And the guy went to school. There are some too, it's just a demonic attack. They will even tell you why they don't like you. So you can pray through it and it changes. But when it comes to the place where you could see that it is bringing things like some kind of verbal strong words and curses and that. Are you getting it? I just wanted to clarify that particular place. Yes. But go ahead with your question.
My question is, what happens if one likes you very much, like mm-hmm. the father likes you, but the mm-hmm. mother doesn't? Do you still run or you stay?
No, those things is subject to change. If you get one to be on your side, it can be very easy to turn it. Those things is very easy to turn it. There is one that become the whole family hate you. Father, mother, in-laws, it's like a kind of a story, but there is, you love each other. But for some reason. Oh, sometimes it may start with maybe the mother. Then he started so winning. He win the father, win all the family. You remember the story we said yesterday? The auntie who didn't, the guy said, initially all my family was on my side, but my auntie has been able to go and convince them. But, however, it can also be that in the case, normally, when you get the father to be on your side, because the fathers that receive the bride thing. Authoritatively, it's the father that has authority. It's not, it's like naming children. It's not women that name children, it's men. So if you get the father to be on your side, he knows how to convince his wife. But I hardly met a case that one person is interested, and unless they are parted, because there are two cases, sometimes both parents are not married yet. They've divorced a long time. And this one is on your side, this one is on your side. The controversy can be some way. But whereby both of them are still married, then it can be very easy to solve it. But all of them, a lot of praying before you even tell somebody I will marry you will solve you a lot of problems. You invest so much prayer. The Holy Ghost can guide you in a way that you will not even go to where you'll be rejected. Because God will not choose a partner for you, but the steps of the good man is ordered by the law. So with prayer, God can order your steps. Amen. Mm-hmm.
Thank you very much, Daddy. This question is a very curious one for me because...
It's a very...
curious question.
Okay.
We've read and seen a lot of marriages that have... we always hear people say, a marriage can make or break you.
Mm-hmm.
And for men specifically, marry a beautiful woman, everything looks well. After the marriage, suddenly... in your mind, you begin to feel the woman wants to manipulate you and destroy you. She says she won't go to church with you again. She wants to be in her own church. You are forced because you want the unity in the marriage to be there. You are forced to even leave your church, go and follow her. Eventually, it's like you are living just to please her throughout. How do you handle situations like that?
Go ahead.
Because you're a spiritual person, you actually hear people telling you, oh, she's possessed. And because you want to hear that, you even get prophets telling you, this woman, she has been sent to come and destroy you. And in your mind, you are totally confused. And just because of the sanctity of the home, you tend to follow her in everything she does. How do you handle this situation? In fact, you're not the man again.
Mm-hmm.
She's the man, and you are the woman. Thank you.
Once Bahumia takes over the leadership of the country, it contradicts the constitution. How do I bring it back? The head of the woman is the man. You are dealing with the spirit of what is called manipulation and the spirit of Jezebel. But it still comes back to the point I'm making. Why didn't you see this during the courtship? You can tell if you are prayerful. Even if he hide it, there is something God will show you. So all these things will happen because there was no proper preparation. And it leads to that. You can't tell. You can't tell during the course. That is why I emphasize that. A proper biblical way of courting can save you a lot of troubles in the marriage. This girl was your friend. You dated her. You courted for at least a year. Go to your house, come to his house, go to church. You see the way she prays. Now, this girl, this my daughter here, is called Regina. She's not married yet. I've seen her come to me, Daddy, pray for me. I'm doing 7 days fasting. I pray. I finished 7 days fasting. I see her come. I'm just to say, for example, Daddy, I want to do 21 days. Daddy, I want to do 30. I think the last time he even did 40 or thereabout. Can you marry such a girl? And one day he tells you that she won't go to church again. No. Do you understand what I'm saying? No. So, it comes because you probably didn't do your homework well. Sometimes, instead of walking in love, we fall in love. And when you fall, you are down. When I was going to marry my wife, I have prophecies and things about where I'm going. It's like Joseph that God said, God gave him his future through a dream. There are things God show you where, even though the reality has not come, but it cannot leave you. Because it's like the vision. Apostle Paul said, I was not disobedient to the heavenly vision. I saw Jesus. He said, oh, King Agrippa, you cannot convince Paul. You can't deceive Paul about this encounter. Agrippa, he said, your much learning has made you mad. Because that is the way Agrippa looked at it. But based on that, I took my wife through a lot of tests. Test of endurance. I've said some of those things in my preaching. How can he handle pressure and that? Everything that I am afraid of, that I've heard people, a woman can stop going to church and all that. I tested it to see. And at the end of the day, based on the way the test result came out from the spiritual laboratory, I concluded that, well, there is hope. And we went ahead. Now, anything you permit, you cannot change. Once you say, let's go to church, you follow. Once you say, this is it. Once you say, it means that you have yielded to the manipulation. You cannot. Anything you permit, you cannot change. If you want to change it, then you can say, hey, this thing, no. No. But however, if the foundation is destroyed, what can the righteous do? So start with the foundation. Today, there is all kinds of things. People meet in church. They don't know each other very well. 1 month, they say they have started counseling. Even if they come and the pastors are trying to straighten them, they won't allow. It will let you appear like you are trying to resist them from getting married. And the pastors give in. Then you marry. Yeah. Hallelujah. One of my daughters, the pastor Martin, brought her. He said he did his wedding on Zoom. Immediately, I said, hey, my friend, go and marry proper. I told Pastor Martin, I said, let's put them together and marry them where? What Zoom? When Jesus was there, was Zoom there?
No.
So immediately I said, I hear. But Pastor Martin, I told him, I said, hey, I don't care what it is. We have to marry you proper. That's what it is. There is a worker here. Yeah, I mean, try to help you. Sometimes, sometimes it came to my spirit to help him about something. Then at the point, you feel like you don't want to do it again. One day, the Lord told me, this thing that you don't want to do for him is an attack. The enemy just don't want you to do it for him. But that is all. And so he came to tell me that anybody that wants to help him sometimes changes his mind. So when I was praying, I decided I'll pray about it. The Lord spoke to me and said, tell him to marry properly. So over the years, he has lived with a woman now, but just become like his normal now. So I told him, I said, go and marry the woman proper. Do engagement and do wedding. And after he did that, I could see that his life is changing. Are you getting it? Sometimes one thing must go on right and all the rest are to just emerge. Yes. So please, the way I will answer you is that, boy, do your homework well. That is why God gives us a room. All this problem comes in when the guy is in Las Vegas and we're in Pram Pram. I have seen so many people come from abroad. They say they are putting it that they came to marry, and they came. Then they come and show me a ring that they have just getting married. It means that they stay in America. They don't know the guy. Maybe they just talk on the phone and all that and bra. Sometimes after 1 year they come and say, "Daddy, do you know my husband? If he has impregnated somebody there, when you are in America, he has stayed here all his life." Doesn't mean there are no women here. You should have come around, stay around. Because if you want a happy, sound marriage, then pay the price for it. That is the way, that is what I can say. But the point is that I don't want you to get to the place and you start gnashing your teeth like, I wish this and that and that. Do your homework well. Recently, my little daughter, I was hard on her because he didn't do well at school. And I said, no, girl, you can't drop your standards. You can't. But I was a little confused because when I look at the subjects, I realized that he did very well. So I went to the school. I said, how can he have this? And the woman told me something. She said, Sofo, the school system we operate is not just what you do at the end of the examination. Your classwork and homework, it consumes 50% or 40 compared to what you do at the school. She did well, but she was not serious with his homework. I said, oh, wow. Wow. Don't only wait for the examination time. Do your homeworks well. Because now, God is going to count part of the homework of what you did before you arrive at the day of the wedding. Amen. Yes, maybe last two questions. I'm getting tired.
All right, Papa. This is about excess. I think there's a lot of questions on the XX.
The menses matter.
Yes.
Did you say, you say X?
X, X.
Oh, okay, okay. I X thought really. What Miriam asked about low menses and high one that the man can fight. Okay, X, right. X, yeah.
So two in one.
Oh, maybe I've got a lot of emails about the X matter. Yeah. Okay.
All right, sir. Uh-huh. Daddy talked about cutting off exes.
Mm-hmm.
What if there was a child with an ex? How do you go about it?
So when is a child with the ex, when you ask me, how do you go about it? So I don't even know how to answer your question.
But now, let me add this onto another ex so that we finish with the ex. All right. How do you handle a situation where it was a failed marriage with children, and then again, he is the only man of God who have access?
Let me answer the first one, then we'll bring the second. I don't want to, because I forgot. Right. Ex. Okay. It means that some people can easily marry. That is what I spoke about. You can marry a woman who has a child already. You can marry a man who has a child already. I know situation of a man who even took the child, added him to their children, they raised him up. The child you have with the man who probably didn't take care of the boy should not connect you to that guy such a way that it affects your marriage. Mm-hmm. Now, the point and the conclusion of this matter here is that most of the cases of the women who try to get connected to their ex end up having sex with them. And that is why I am categorically saying that, for instance, in America, a lot of people have XX and with children. There's something they call child support. It's a system they put in America. You don't need a man. It's a particular account to pay into it. What do you really need the man for? What do you need the man for? Fine. There are men that when the marriage, the relationship doesn't work, there are situations that, you see, sometimes you can't force us to generalize your peculiar situation, because yours cannot be the general situation for everybody. I have seen situations where, let's say, the boy was a bad boy, impregnated you when you were courting. Their parents will take the child. It means the boy's parents take the child. Sometimes the girl's parents take the child. Sometimes too, the girls with the child, that they take the child to the next marriage. In the context of this question, he's trying to say that, what about you have a child? If you have a child with him, now he has become an ex. And for the sake of the new marriage, don't entertain anything. Even if you have nothing to do with that man, naturally, it can create a jealousy between the way you work with him and your new marriage. And it can destroy the new marriage. Because one time, you are in the guise of, your husband asks you, where are you going? I want to collect school fees. Maybe your husband will tell you, I've told you not to go there and collect school fees again. The fact that you have married now, you can have all kinds of relationships, you have anyone not married. But once you have now raising a new home, you have married a new man, maybe you have children with him. Don't cut off the man. There are so many ways. If it is contributing to support his child, there must be some account to put it there. There is an account here, put the money there. I'll pay your son's school. Or your son go to school at GIS, go there, pay the school fees. If you want to give some money to keep up, please, do this. Stay out of him for the sake of your new marriage. Because a sensitive man that you are married, if the new marriage you marry, the man is a sensitive man, as a result of, look at the story we read now. This girl is married, went to DVLA to go and change his passport or his license or something. His ex-husband is doing a workshop there. He didn't just follow him to a hotel. Maybe it may start with a conversation. Maybe let's go for lunch. From the lunch, as they talk, the devil has now come in. Then, before you know, you are in his hotel room, and all you say is that he kissed you. I was high there. If you took a woman to a hotel room, you are there alone and kiss her, and then all the kissing that you after the kissing he goes, you are a tree. No, who are you going to say this announcing story for them to accept? No. Are you getting the point now? So I am emphatically saying that if you marry and you have any ex relationship, cut off. Period. If you want to sustain your former marriage, particularly when your new husband is aware, when your wife is aware, the man, cut off. The woman, cut off. Anybody you have had sex with before, you can easily have sex with the person again. Build boundaries. Also for the next question. So tell him, whether they are children, there are so many ways for you to take care of his child. And I want to tell you, most of them, when you marry, they don't even take care of the child. They only come when the child is about to marry. Yeah. Then they come and make a kakabensem. Yeah. No, there's a case of when the girl went to marry, is the girl's stepfather who raised the child. When the girl was about to marry, the man came in, it became even a battle. And the girl told his father, I don't know you. He told his biological father, I don't know you. And if you are going to come and take, are we even married? Because it's his stepfather who took care. At the point, the girl herself took her stepfather's name. Because she took the girl like his daughter. And there was, you know, she even loved the girl more than her own biological children. He was a child. He was a very spiritual, I think, like a deacon or something in the church. Then during the wedding, this man came here. And the girl faced his father seriously. Yeah. And later, people stepped in and told the man to stay aside. And he stayed aside. He only attended the wedding. He didn't even go there to sign the register. They didn't permit him. The girl herself said, I won't let you sign the register. I have nothing to do with you. I respect you. But no. When the mother brought her to marry, the girl was 2 years old. And now he's 29. And the man has taken care of her till he has finished master's degree. She's coming. He paid her school fees to go to school in America. You only appear to come and collect back. And the guy said no. And it was in a church, so other people came in. And they said, no, please. He's one of them. Stay away from this matter. So, please, I'm telling you. 80% of the emails I've gotten that the marriage is in drugs. When they read, it comes back that some ex is infringing on the thing. This whole X factor thing, stay away from it.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Now, so go ahead.
How do you handle a situation where it was a failed marriage with children, and then again he is the only man of God who you have access to by way of helping you with the interpretation of dreams and general understanding of spiritual issues you face,
hey,
and is guiding you to deal with them? In fact, he is still a major part of your life when it comes to spiritual matters.
Sir, I'm into question as you. But me the jargons, this grammar, I'm confused.
But I think they were married.
Uh-huh.
She was married to a man of God,
uh-huh,
and then the marriage failed,
uh-huh,
and then she's married again. But
so the former man is still the interpreter to his dreams,
and he plays a major role in
his personal prophet.
That's it.
What is the answer to it?
Cut off.
Cut him off. Tell her to come, I will interpret the dreams. Yeah, the point is that you said he's a man of God. Don't even go and tempt him. Maybe he's married again. You see, I don't want you to be a negative testimony. Don't be on that side. I don't want to, listen, I don't care what you ask about your ex. Cut him or her off. It will save your future. I'm telling you. Cut him or her off. Don't store his number on the phone. Don't have any communication with him or her. When you meet him or her in some program, good morning, pass. Don't sit down and engage in a conversation. Unless you are above 70 years. I know, cry, be careful. Because Sarah was 70. No, the reason is that, listen, don't play game. The devil is, you are playing with the enemy. Some of them, it's not that they went in. You see, a lady told me, said, Daddy, I didn't even know how it happens. All of them tell me, I didn't know how it happens. We were just, in fact, I have not even, and listen, the one that is interesting is that some of them, they have not met the guys for 12 years. When they parted, it's about 12 years ago. He's married for 40 years. He met a guy. And then suddenly they started talking. And he said, one day, I didn't know what is happening. He gave me a lift. And then in the lift, we were sitting in a car. We have sex in a car. Yes. You know, you say, oh, haven't they squeezed you in a car before? Is it a mystery that's coming from another planet? And that, so, you see, once you create the atmosphere for the enemy, you take advantage of it. After 12, there are some that are more than 12 years. You have parted. Your ex is exo. Unless he's dead. Even in the cemetery, anything can happen. No, take it straight. I am trying to emphasize that point. I don't care whatever connects you to her, whether children, job, and I'm telling you, I believe if you are married and you apply for a job and you are a secretary, you are going to be a secretary. And when they brought you to the boss, that you are going to be a secretary to this particular department, the man there is your ex and you are married, resign. That day, now hand over the appointment and go. If you want to keep your marriage, that's all. There is a price you pay to keep your marriage. It means that if you come to church and Pastor Abbott's office, you are going to work there. And for example, Pastor Abbott is, you are going to be his secretary. You realize that when he was in tech, he used to be his ex. Immediately come to me and say, Daddy, I don't want the job again. That's all. Whether he's a pastor or anything, I'm telling you, if the ex was from kindergarten, cut him off. That is it. All of them, I'm telling you. It is, I don't know, but from what I read about Bill Gates, it looks like the breaking of his marriage has to do with his ex. Mm-hmm. It is on the internet. Go and read it. You read the story. That is what happened to Prince Charles. No, the stories are there. That is it. If you know the story, Camilla used to be his ex. So because of that one, he and Dinah never was happy. Once you entertain it, you cut off. You keep texting your ex. You say, who couldn't wish you? What's Todino? Body I had to. And I will test it. So if what's Todino driver? What's Todino college? You is your college? You think you are smarter than all those is demonic manipulation. You'll be in the trouble. Yeah. You think all the names on your phone contact is the right name? No. Don't deceive yourself. The Bible says, whatever you sow, you reap. Don't entertain it. Don't. Whether you are a pastor, anything, don't. Anybody you have had sex with before and you are now in a new relationship, don't entertain that person. The enemy will use them to destroy your relationship. And after it destroys, they won't marry you. Because if they will really want to marry you, you become their ex. All the stories I read to you yesterday, almost all of them have to do with their ex. Every one of them. Everyone. Yeah. Every one of them has to do with their ex. Okay, last question from the inside. Yes. Give it to this man. Wow. Are we learning? Yes. Mm-hmm. I'm sure God will help us. Our marriages will get better. Yes. Mm-hmm.
Thank you, Papa. I want to ask, since we are young men and we are trying to get married, what is the role of a woman in a family when you marry? Because now you meet women who think the responsibility of the home should be shared equally. It's not like come and help me, but like you are supposed to do this and that. I want to ask that, is this something that is scriptural, and is this something that women should start advancing for? And then the second one I want to ask, I want to know.
Wait, let me answer the first one first. you see, when we finish preaching a message and you ask a questionnaire. The way you ask your questionnaire, it is very difficult to answer it because it depends on the kind of person you married. If you say the responsibility of the home should be shared, I have seen men who marry because of the state where they are and they are well to do. They don't even want their wife to work. You understand what I'm saying? If you work in a bank, your wife also, you work in Ecoba, your wife work in Zenith Bank. You are all what the society call like average, is that what they call? Somebody you can also marry, and the guy is a businessman. I have one of my daughters here. His husband has his own company. The company is, he's doing very well. The lady works in a bank. One day I call and I said, resign from the bank and join your husband. I told him, I said, resign. How much salary? The salary they are paying, your husband can pay you 4 times. Support him at the work because of the nature. Are you getting it? If I get your question well, you want to find out whether it's biblical that the responsibility of the home should be shared. When you say responsibility of the home should be shared, what kind of responsibilities are you talking about? It's a very broad subject to deal with. The answer may give to you may affect another person. What I may tell you may affect, because we are in different levels, different classes, different backgrounds, different way of handling things. And when you come to Ghana, culture, tradition, tribe, everything. Yes. So it's very difficult. And it all comes back to understanding. Understanding between the two of you. Transparency. That's all. I work in Ecoma, my pay is 15,000. You work in Zenith Bank, your pay is 10,000. So if there's transparency, this two family has 25,000 a month. If I can come from the way I started, this is what we have. What do we do? Okay. We save your own. We manage my own. There are families that I know. Recently, one of them told me, the family said, I was preaching, one of them told me, said that the man is the one who does the project. He said, okay, girl, you take care of all the house thing, food, cooking, children, everything that has to keep the home. But the building that we are building, leave it for me. I'm going to handle the project. So once I use my money, and everybody's accountable. For instance, me and mommy, we put monies somewhere and everybody, but we don't abuse it. Do you understand? All these things come with understanding. So it's very difficult. And you can't say from the Bible does not tell us how Paul said that if a man does not take care of his family, he is worse than an infidel. Are you getting it? So you, the man, has a responsibility. And normally in the society, it's expected that the man will do better than the woman. But now our generation has changed. You can come to church and marry. I have people in this church, the women are richer than the men. They are far wealthier than the man. So all depends on the kind of person you marry. How you are, both of you are united. Your understanding about how to handle things. And the foundation of how you started. And then you build it up. So I don't want to go and answer and tell you that, what you are saying now. If I get your question right, you say now, they say what? What did you say?
Shared responsibility.
This person will do this. Let me ask you a question. In your mind, what kind of responsibilities are you talking about?
Okay, so for instance, cooking, taking care of the homes, cleaning the home. Who is responsible for making sure that there is always money in the house to take care of home, and then who is actually responsible to make sure that the home is clean, everything is in order.
Okay, let me ask you a question. If you marry and your wife does not do any work, because there are people who have married in the church, the women don't do anything, but the men, the girl in the church, the girl, let's say, he just completed university, he has not gotten a job yet, but you feel like you'll be in a good position to take care till you get a job. That means that from the time you get a job, the responsibility is going to be on you. However, that is different from what you are talking about, if I'm getting you right. Like, it's not everything that you need money, like keeping the home, like things like cleaning bathroom, washing and stuff. Like me, when I marry, mommy believed that we're doing Saturday. Every Saturday morning, we go to all night, we close. and that day weekly or holidays. So scrubbing, sometimes when he's cooking, then maybe I'm cleaning there. There are some things I don't like doing it. So I'll tell the girl, this one I'm in penny, this one I won't do it. So me, I prefer to support you in the kitchen than going to clean a bathroom. I won't clean. Hallelujah. So, and fine, she will do it. So those things are just you support. But basically what brings the problem is, and now I'll talk about it at the dinner. I know where you are coming from, but I'm going to talk about it, go to dinner. I'm going to stay with sex and money. And I'm going to share some practical examples with you. Yes, your second question.
Yes, my second question is, what is the role of temperament? When you meet someone who has a different temperament, what should be your decision? What should be your approach?
Mm-hmm. The reason why I don't talk about those things is that choleric and whatever, sanguine, whatever they call it, is that no temperament is wrong. No temperament is wrong. However, it is good to line your temperament with the word of God. That means that they say the opposite attract. Between me and mommy, I'm very outspoken. I am extrovert. We are direct opposite. He's an introvert person. See that? Sometimes even talking is difficult for her. I sometimes have pushed her and then, but naturally, she's a quiet person. She doesn't like to. I talk. And I am an action man. Let's do the thing. Kaka, kaka, kaka. That is the way it is. It doesn't mean something is wrong with me. That is what God gave it to me. Temperamental. All those things, you just have to. That is why I say that. When you marry, you must accept your partner the way they are. So it comes back to proper courtship. It's not now that I'm going to force it. Oh, I don't know how they are. Why is this? Why is it mumu? Who to us? No, that's what it is. If I wanted to talk now, after 20 years, I know the things I can do for her to talk. But I didn't force her out. Yes. And so, the temperament and those things is God giving gift to everybody. Some people like talking. Some people don't like talking. Some people are extremely introvert. Some people are extremely extrovert. Some people, when they come to this place, everybody know they are there. Hey, challenge, say, hey, what's up? Hey. Some people can make friends easily. For instance, and you see, marriage has power to change you. Before I married, I used to be friends. I love those, oh, my friend. Naturally, my wife changed me from that. Not that he forced me. She's the person that doesn't go out. I have met, up to date, we meet some of his clubs. Hey, pastors of mommy. From school up to now, he will never visit you at home. I think it's an upbringing from his house. His mother didn't permit them to go out and become friends. But I used to that. But because he doesn't go out, you naturally have to stay home. And I took that path. And it has really helped me. Up to date, I don't really. When the reverend used to ask me, do you really have a friend? I said, oh, yeah, I have friends. Do you have somebody who go to the house visit? I said, no, not that. No. So there is a lot of things. If you position yourself, your marriage will help you and change you and just tune you to become better. So temperament wise, no problem. Don't marry a woman who doesn't talk, who doesn't like talking, and tell her after marriage you want to force her to talk. No. And don't try to change your husband and say, oh, pekasa too much. No. Because if two quiet people are in the house, you have mumus in the house. Somebody have to create him. But this is the bottom line. No temperament is wrong. Amen. Final question. This one, after that, I won't talk again. I saw somebody's hand up. Osofu, do we have anything online?
No.
Okay, then stand to your feet. Can I ask a question? What do you do if you marry? Your husband is active with sex. Because there's another trend to unpicking. Then suddenly, he stopped firing. And the reason is because he's under attack. And he cannot have election. And you have married for 3 years. What do you do? Expect the best. Do you know there is human tradition they put in a marriage called for better for worse? Yes, sir. You know why they put it there? It, even though it's not biblical. But up to date, some churches does it. Especially when you go to the evangelicals and the orthodox, they will say for better, for worse, for brighter, for darker, for day, for night, for river, for swimming. All of them are there. Why did they put it there? Because they anticipate that sometimes you must expect the worst. You have asked me a question. I mean, to ask you a question, you are sitting down. What do you do? Because it's happening. And the seriousness about those things is that when it happens, from the experience I'm getting, the men just withdraw. It is difficult for them to tell their wife this is what is happening. They hide behind all kinds of things. But that is really the reality. How you structure your matrimonial home and how closer you get to your spouse and how you become like friends, spouse, soulmate and all that and become transparent is very important. So men easily will tell the wife that, honey, this is what I'm experiencing. Some to base on the attitude of the wife, they cannot tell. And they just find a way. I don't have any feelings towards you, but that might not be the case. Some might be a spiritual attack. That if the person comes to church and say it, maybe through prayer, God can restore. Because I've prayed for people like that several times in my ministry, both local and international, that God has restored their potency. But most cases, I've also found out the devil's trap that when they start, they even withdraw from church. Because one of the devil's greatest attack is that he doesn't want you to go where you can get delivered. What do you do? I pray that you'll be part of the Sunday dinner session. Because that one is not going to be a shallow teaching. We are going to go to some dimensions. And I'm going to tell you that. Things are going to happen. There is a new case. It just came to me that the woman said, after 6 years of marriage, anytime my husband is trying to fire, I have excruciating pain to the extent that I have resisted him sex for the past 2 months. But after hearing you, I realized, what do I do? And he said, I've been to every gynecologist. They still tell me there's nothing wrong. But he said, I go through pain. I concluded that it might be spiritual. So anyway, I told her, find your way to come to Portes during the 70 days. Let's pray with you and believe God. Expect the best. It all comes back to what I'm talking about. If you become spiritual and out of your spirituality, God bless you with a partner. Don't be carnal after you marry. If your marriage is born by prayer, it must be sustained by prayer. That means, unfortunately, rather, I've seen most of them after marriage. They rather begin to withdraw from God with the excuse of job and children. Children must not be an excuse why you won't be committed to the things of God. Shouldn't be. And this is where all the time the trouble starts. Please, be spiritual.